Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. So what do we have today? Well, we have something I've been talking about since the very beginning of the year. I think I mentioned it in my New Year's resolutions, and I alluded, oh, it's going to be coming up. Well, it finally did. We built a chisel plane. That's right. We have a homemade plane here at Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. Had a chance to use it a couple of times, and I've gotten some really great results with it. So starting today, we're going to do two parts, and we're going to discuss building a jig that you will use to pretty much make the body of this, and then we'll go into the actual construction. To be honest with you, I think between building the jig and then doing all the milling and everything for this, you maybe have to invest about a day, but once you get that jig built, it's literally maybe just a couple hours to build one entire chisel plane. So let's go ahead and take a look at this one. And I want to show you where I got the start from this. I was just using some scrap that I had laying around. In fact, just for a little piece of trivia, I picked this up off of a pallet from a delivery we had here at the house when we had some flooring not so long ago. And basically it's maple and it works great. Now it was a little wet when I first got it, so it's been sitting around and acclimating to my shop. And that was the most important thing, was to get this wood as dry as possible in comparison to the shop. So I have about an average relative humidity of about 6 to 8% is what the majority of the wood's coming in at. If it was a little bit less than that, it would come up to the 6 to 8%. If it's wetter, then it comes down. So I get it as close as possible. Now, one thing I also was very lucky was when I looked at the grain pattern, I want the grain to basically go side to side, as close to like quarter sawn as possible, because remember, we want to limit the wood movement as much as possible. Because one thing with the chisel, and we'll grab the one that we've built here, and you can kind of see it on here. If the wood movement is side to side, that's not really that big of a deal. But if it was up and down, it could change the pitch here on the cutting angle itself, and that wouldn't be good. It'd be very minimal, but you know what? It could potentially be enough to be very noticeable. Now, the overall design is one that I had mentioned this before, and a lot of you sent in, hey, was this the article in Fine Woodworking that you were talking about? And yep, you know what, guys? You were absolutely right. So I'll make sure to have links for it in the show notes so that you too can find that particular article. If you have that subscription to Fine Woodworking online, you'll be able to get the PDF itself. Otherwise, you'll be able to find the information and maybe even order it if you don't have it. Now, the overall length of the chisel plane comes in at about 7 inches in length, but the blank, before we get it to this final product, needs to be a little bit longer. In fact, probably about 9 inches is best. And you'll find out why as we go into the video. It has a lot to do with the jig and keeping your fingers out of the way of the blades. The thickness, mine happens to be about 1.5 inches. And the very first prototype, which I probably should have brought over here, I ended up just laminating some pieces together to get a nice thick piece and so that I could work with it. So start a little oversized, maybe even up to 2 inches, and then work your way down. And then, of course, the thickness is about, it's about 1.5 inches wide or thick. And another thing is, mine is still kind of in a rough form. I'm going to end up rounding over these edges. In fact, here in the back, one thing I found is with these square edges, even if I just simply rounded over the corners themselves, it'd probably be better if I did a complete round over so it fit into the palm of my hand just a little bit more. But when it comes to using the chisel plane, and we explained this earlier, the main thing is to keep all your pressure here, because the one thing the chisel plane wants to do is, since it doesn't have a toe in front of the mouth, once that blade engages, it wants to dive down hard into the material. So by having a good platform that you can push down here, put all your weight here to push down and then cut, that's how you control the chisel plane. But you know what, we'll try and explain that later on. So anyways though, what do we have to do? Well, of course, we have the blank. The other pieces that you're going to need are essentially just a 3/4 to 1 inch set screw, and it's about 1/4 inch in overall. Of course, I'll have as much information as possible in the show notes about this. Just a simple washer. This cap iron, essentially is what it is made from scraps from the chisel plane itself. And of course, you'll see this in the video. And you're going to need a 1/4 inch inset screw. I ended up picking up mine from like Woodcraft. You can get all these supplies most likely at just a decent home center. If you're lucky, you have one of those little hometown hardware stores that has everything. You can pick it up there. Honestly, the most expensive thing that I had to get for the chisel plane was I ended up going out and getting a Hawk blade. And you know what? I love this thing. This was $35, I think, at Woodcraft. But it was $35 for this and probably about literally $1 to $2 more for absolutely everything else that we needed. So that's a good start. Let's go ahead and talk next about getting the body set for what we need to do before we take it over to the jig, and then we'll demonstrate what we need to do with the jig. Okay, so the first thing that we need to do is to make the jig itself. And one thing with our chisel plane is, like I said, the bed itself is a 20 degree angle. So we need to make a jig that, rather than ourselves trying to hold this and push it through the table saw blade, what I want to do is create a jig that essentially is going to hold this much like a harness, kind of hold it in place, and then that way the jig is what's going to get close to the table saw blade and not your fingers. So the first thing we need to do is to establish a 20 degree bevel or an angle on the jig itself. And that's what we're going to do next. Essentially, I take this piece, I'll draw that 20 degree out, and then mark the lines down the faces of both sides, so like where the toe is and then where the top is. We'll transfer those to the jig and we'll get started with there. So that's what we're going to do next, is moving on to the jig portion. And then the rest of it, we'll just go and we'll make this. And like I said, once you get that jig built, literally it takes only a few hours to make a bunch of these. And you know what? You just get excellent results, and then you can modify it any way you want to. So let's get started. Okay, so the first thing I need to do is create a jig so that I can get this 20 degree angle on here. And what I ended up doing was I drew the 20 degrees here on the body of the plane. I gave myself a reference line that ran down the surface, which was more or less, as soon as I knew where 20 degrees was on here, I could draw some reference lines, went across the surface with the square, drew a line down for the reference, and then the same on the back side of this, which I could then transfer to my jig, or what would be my jig stock. And what we're going to end up doing is, here, we'll use, this is the original jig, and then this is the new one we're going to do because it's a little bit thicker, which gives a little bit more support. Is what I ended up doing was transferring that 20 degrees to the jig itself. Now, I've got all my lines on here, and if you have any questions about it, please, I will definitely give you more information about it. But what it really comes down to is, once I got the 20 degree line drawn on there, I then knew that, well, I wanted this piece here at the back to be 90 degrees. So based off of that 20 degree line, it was just a matter of kind of setting the square and striking the line. Now, so that I can reference the fence underneath, again, I drew lines down so that I could reference them. And my next step is to get this in position using those reference lines, so that I can safely run the sled through, keeping my hands completely out of the way. All right, there we go. That's just about where I want it. Not just about, it is where I want it. Okay, so let's go ahead and drill this into place. Okay, that one's there. That one's there. Make sure they're not protruding out the bottom. That would really bite on the surface. Okay, so that's pretty solid. I've raised the blade as high as I can get it so that it is going to cut through. No, I'm not going to make a cut all the way. I'm going to stop as soon as I get to my lines. So remember, I made that 20 degree line and then I made a 90 degree off of that. So I have these intersecting lines here. So the cut's going to come up, stop, and then we're going to take it off and we're going to reposition this so we can make this cut. And then that's how we'll get that opening right there for our jig. And once we have that, the rest of it, man, it goes really, really fast. So the first thing we're going to do is, now that we have this, I'm going to put on my safety equipment and we're going to make the cut. Okay, so that was really, really easy. As you saw, it was just a matter of attaching it to the sled, took it off, and again, referenced those lines, pushed it through, kept my hands out of the way. The worst part about it was the blade wasn't quite as high as I wanted it to, but you know what? I have a smaller table saw. In fact, it's an 8-inch blade, but it was able to get through without a problem. And as you saw, it looked totally great, and it's going to work fantastic. Now, onto the body of the plane itself. The body is about 1 5/8 inches in total width. So that's what we're going to go ahead and we're going to rip this piece of stock down to that 1 5/8. And then we're going to cut it to the length that we need so that we can move on to the next portion. Because once we get the basic dimensions roughed out and everything, getting it on the jig is really, really simple. And that's half the battle, to be honest with you. Once we get this part done, the rest of it is just a matter of attaching the hardware and getting it up and going. I think maybe the only other thing that could be worse is the making the cap iron. But you know what? That's no big deal. We'll go ahead and take care of that pretty easily. So anyways, though, let's go ahead and move this to our 1 5/8 inch. And there we go, right about there. All right. And it's okay if it's a little off, a little bit wide, you know, whatever it is that you need it to be. So go ahead and once again, put the safety equipment back on here. And we'll go ahead and make the cut. Ah, masks. They're so much fun. Okay, we are all set. Get our safety equipment and let's go. Fingers and thumbs, don't be dumb. Nice steady pace. Oh yeah. Oh, this is going to be beautiful. Definitely. Okay, so we've got that to the right thickness, the right width. All right. Now I'm going to leave it a little long, and I have still yet to touch the top here. I'm not worried about it. I'm going to put it in the jig next, and we're going to cut that 20-degree angle. And then, like I said, the rest of it from there, it's really, really easy. So the next thing is let's go ahead and mount it in the jig.